Yeah. praise in your name, showing our love to you. We thank you so much for this opportunity to come together as your kingdom, Heavenly Father, to worship you together, to commune to you as one Heavenly Father. We ask your blessings on this worship service, Heavenly Father. Please help us to be pleasing to you and acceptable to you. Help us to worship you with spirit and truth. Help us to be drawn closer together, to understand your word better, to apply all that's being taught to us to our lives. Heavenly Father, we praise your name as the creator of all things, as the giver of life, as the one who came down with his head, has had his son come down to die for our sins, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, we ask for the forgiveness of our sins, of our ignorance and our selfishness, Heavenly Father. We ask for your blessings in keeping us on the straight and narrow path. Heavenly Father, please keep us from temptation. Help us to focus on you. Heavenly Father, we ask to be with the leaders of this congregation, those who are leading the services. Please bless them, Heavenly Father. Please send your spirit to speak through them. Please be with Larry as he leads us singing and Gary. And please be with Steve as he gives us the message, and Mike as he leads the children, Heavenly Father. Please bless us all as we worship you. Heavenly Father, we thank you for those who are gathered together this morning. We thank you for the love and dedication they have for you. Heavenly Father, please be with those who are not able to make it, those who do not know you, those who are seeking you out and need help. Please send them our way. Help us to administer them, to teach them, to love them, to show them your word, to show them your kingdom. Heavenly Father, we ask that you be with the leaders of this nation. Please help us to turn back to you. Please help us to put you first. Please help us to be the nation that you want us to be. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your love. We thank you so much for your blessings. And we ask your blessing this morning on this worship service. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Please be seated.
wrong term here, but if something's in your, bothering you in your life, or something that you don't feel you do right, you have a tendency to hang on a little bit. I worry about this time having my mind in the right place, thinking right. But it says, in every example that I got, a quick look, do this in remembrance. Remember, you have to think. Maybe being what I was in the first 6 years of my life, that case, doing everything as fast and good, but fast as you can, a production worker, I got in the habit of snapping things off. I caught myself a few years ago snapping off towards the table. So that's why I emphasize think, remember every time, because I have a problem with it. If you go, you know, forgive me for hounding at you or pounding a thought, but I think as human beings we have a tendency to do that. I took a trip across the state to deliver my son to Western Park for Rabbi. 34 is littered with signs and memorials. The Indian chiefs that live in that area, I guarantee you, they didn't lay down and go sleep someplace and somebody didn't put a marker on to remember. As human beings, we know that about ourselves. We leave physical markers, things that remind us, so we think. And I spent my time again about thinking, but like I said, if you don't have a problem with it, cut me some slack as I do. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I humbly approach you in prayer this time. We ask a blessing upon us as we're about to take the bread at this time and the cup later. Lord, help us to have our mind where it belongs, centered back on you. Help us to glean from this memorial feast what we should and what we need to. And dear Lord, I thank you so much for sending your Son and having the thought for our salvation through him. And it's through his name I pray. Amen. Thank you.
Blessed the country,
Lord, we come before you today so thankful for the blessings that you give us each and every day. So many blessings that, quite frankly, we take for granted, Lord. Help us to remember that as we give back to you, as you physically need nothing from us, Lord, but we do need to take up a collection to do the efforts that you want done in your labor, Lord. Help us to make the decisions that need to be made to best glorify you, Lord, to best bring about your word to the community that needs you so very much. We love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Kiddos, we're up.
Heading out front. I'll race you. Those things. So, how are we supposed to cry with other people that cry But until we start being honest with each other, we're never going to be able to help each other out. We're never going to be able to bear each other's burdens, cry with the people who cry, lift each other up until we start being honest. So then I start thinking, I want to take this a step further. I start thinking about myself, because I do the exact same thing. You know who else I do it to? I do it to God. When I'm praying, I'm not always honest with God. And guess what? He already knows. He knows how I feel. But I'm not always honest with him. So here's some things, here's some action steps. Here's some action steps for next time. I want you guys to be sincere. Be sincere. When somebody asks you if they're sincere, I want you to share with them. And next time you pray to God, be honest. He knows anyway. He knows anyway. I think somehow in our culture we've done ourselves an injustice. We put up this shell. We put up this front. We always have to tell.
Hope everyone is feeling good,
and I mean that, I'm sincere. Kind of take Mike's lesson a step further. If you ever travel abroad, don't ever ask anybody how they're doing, because that's a personal question. You either get punched or they'll tell you. If you got up in the morning and you looked out your window and you saw a lion in front of your house, what would you do? I mean, think about it. Obviously, in our neck of the woods, they're not common. Most of us would be shocked. From our text, the reaction that many people have would be wrong. I mean, think about it. There's a lion in the street. Valiant fighter from Kabzeel,
who performed great exploits. He struck down two of Moab's best men. He also went down into a pit on a snowy day and killed a lion. Now that sounds pretty neat, doesn't it? I mean, he was a valiant warrior. He was a fighter. And obviously, he had courage. You know, the first thing we notice about it is that he killed the enemies of the war. Then he killed one. The Bible here doesn't explain what the circumstances is. It doesn't explain why this lion was in a pit on a snowy day. It doesn't explain if he was chasing it. But we know that it was in the pit and he went down there and killed it. An act of courage. You know, common sense tells us when we see a lion run, he stood up to the challenge. He went and he conquered. It takes courage to overcome. It takes courage not to let fear win. Friends, if anybody ever tells you, "I've never been afraid of anything," I would venture to say they're a liar. Everybody's got something that causes fear in them. And it can be different for a lot of people. The number one fear in the United States of America, public speaking. Think about that. The fear of dying is third on the list, which tells us people would rather die than get up in front of a crowd and speak. Now, when you put it that way, isn't that silly? To think I would give up my life before I had to stand in front of a crowd and speak. Why is it? Because we're afraid of rejection. We're afraid people won't like what we have to say. Well, friends, if we are saying the things that are on our heart, if we are saying the things, especially as Christians, if we are talking of godly things, it doesn't matter if people care for us or not. It doesn't matter if people reject us or not. Some of you are sitting down here now saying, "This guy's in love." Well, you're right. You know what? I don't care. Because I'm in it for God. I want to do what He has called me to do. I want to preach His word. You know, Ben and I went out with courage to kill the Lord's enemies. And he conquered more. If you look at verse 21. He says, "And then he struck down a huge Egyptian, although the Egyptian had a spear in his hand. Ben and I went against him with a club, and he snatched the spear from the Egyptian's hand and killed him with his own spear." That's kind of insult to injury. But understand who Benaniah was. He was one of David's valiant warriors. You know, and maybe he was influenced by David. Remember when David fought Goliath? Remember how Goliath, all decked out in all of his armor? He had his sword and he had his spear. And David had a sling. And Goliath challenged and said, "You send me a boy with sticks and stones?" And David put that stone in his forehead. He fell, and David took Goliath's sword and cut off his head. So maybe Benaniah was influenced by David. I can take you out in your own way. Not of my own goes on. Even though Ben and I did not rank or attain the same rank as David's top three, pay close attention to what he did. He was held in greater honor than any of the 30, but he was not included among the three. And David put him in charge of his bodyguard. David knew that he could be courageous. You know, it seems he lived his life with no regrets. When he saw a challenge, he overcame. He accepted it. He didn't live in fear. When you think about who we are, what we do, most people will tell you that our biggest regrets, or their biggest regrets, were things they didn't do. A lot of people look back in their life, oh, if I would have only taken this opportunity. Oh, if I had only taken this chance. And you can probably think about it now. Things in the past thinking, that was an opportunity I should have taken. In the short term, most folks regret action. Bad decisions. Well, if I wouldn't have done this, this wouldn't have happened. But in the long term, it's usually inaction that's regretted. If I would have done this, then this wouldn't have happened. I mean, I'm sure that we can all look back at things we regret. Here's David, one of David, of one of his things that he did in the short term. David was conscience stricken after he had counted the fighting men, and he said to the Lord, I have sinned greatly in what I have done. Now, Lord, I beg you to take away the guilt of your servant. I've done a very poor thing. You know, personally, I know I can come up with so many regrets, and most of them hinge on a spur of the moment decision. Instead of sitting down thinking about it, instead of praying, instead of allowing God to lead. Here, in this particular case, David was told, you don't need to count them in your mind. And he did it anyway. He did it anyway. And then he regretted it. Don't do this and be okay. You see, a lot of our modern day churches seem to have adhered to a teaching of don't do certain things in your heart. Now, don't get me wrong, as Christians, there are certain things we don't need to be a part of. There are things in this world that go on and we do not need to allow to influence us. But just because I don't do something isn't going to make me okay. You know, the problem is that you can do nothing wrong and still do nothing right. Look what James says in James 4:17. Anyone then who knows the good that he ought to do and doesn't do it, sins. I saw a poster one time that had a picture of a man sitting on a railroad track. And the caption read, you can be on the right track, but if you don't move, you're still going to be on the road. Think about what that means. You know, we can eliminate all the bad from our life. We can take away the things that aren't good for us. We can take away the negatives. But if we don't apply the positives, if we don't get active, we're not really in any better shape.
but about allowing God to cleanse us, to use us for His service in the Lord. When things are made holy, they're set apart for service to God. In order to serve God, we have to be useful. You see, Christianity is active. It's not passive. Well, I've been baptized. I'm in. What about everything else that tells you you were created by God to do good works? What about love God? First and foremost, to love your neighbor as yourself. You see, love's an action word. If we're going to love, it's going to be demonstrated in our life. And that love is going to be demonstrated by serving others. Man, I appreciate Gary's comments this morning about making me a servant. Because as we sing that week after week, oftentimes it just becomes a song we sing. And do we truly pray that? God, make me a servant. Make me like you. That takes courage. To want to be just like Jesus. I mean, when we go back and we read the account of what he did, that's just what we know of, because John said there's so much more. Am I willing to do that? Am I ready to be a servant just like Jesus? Am I ready to get rid of all my own agenda and live completely for God? Am I going to forget about myself and think about others first? Scary. And it's scary because it's not easy, because we all have this little thing in our life called ego. Some people, it goes a little bit bigger than other people. But it's just part of what Satan's able to work with us to get us to focus on me. But it's just scary sometimes. You know, I'm sure you've all heard, be careful what you pray for, because you're trying to adjust it. And I use that a lot, especially when I hear people pray for our country, and believe me, I think our country needs more prayers than we can lift up. I honestly believe that. But when you go back and you look at God's people through time, how did he get them to return to him? He oppressed them. He sent somebody to conquer them. He sent somebody to get them to focus on him rather than themselves. Is that what we're praying for? Or are we willing to accept that? That's what God decides. Fine. You want America to be a country again? A godly country again? All sense of all godly people went into control you for a while. It's frightening to think that can happen, because we're America. But we was only America, land of the free and home of the brave, as long as we was a country, one nation under God. Once we start pushing that out, well, then we've got problems. You remember what Paul wrote to Timothy? There'll come a day when people we still have to hurt him, would we still be here today? Think about it. Then think about this. It takes guts to be God. We're called to be different, and it takes courage to be different. We like to fit in. We like to be accepted. So it takes courage to be different from everybody else. I heard a guy once say, you know how you can tell a nonconformist? He looks like all the other nonconformists. And that's kind of like, you know, people, I want to make a statement. You and 15 million other people. But it takes guts to be godly, to allow him to show each and every day. Paul wrote in Romans 12 and verse 2, do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and prove what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world. We can look around and we can see the pattern of this world is not good. And Paul wrote this long before we ever came along. Transform your thinking. Renew your mind. And we have to do this, friends, each and every day because Satan's out there each and every day bombarding our mind. You know, and the worst thing is, it seems like that these bad things, these negative things, they stick with us. No matter what we do. Well, we can forget people's names. I mean, I do that quite often. We can forget where we put things. But it seems like these negative things that are put in our mind, they stay there forever. It's like they're burnt permanent. I knew a man who was a very good Christian and great servant of God. But before he was a Christian, when he was in the military, he said, one of the things that I regret more than anything is the watching of pornography, because I cannot get those images out of my mind even now, 20 years later, after becoming a Christian. He said, they're burnt in there. They're imprinted in there. I can't get rid of that. See, we've all heard the old saying, you can't unsee something in your mind. You can't unsee it. But yet, God says, renew your mind. So every day, we've got to be looking into God's Word. We've got to be trusting Him to lead us and direct us and take us the direction we need to go. We've got to have the courage to be different. Where do we get this courage? We get it from God. That's the only place we can get it. He's the only one that can withstand. He's the only one that has conquered Satan. So why do we fear? Where do we get this fear? Well, it has to come from Satan. Paul also wrote in 2 Timothy 1:7, for God gave us a spirit, not of fear, but of power and of love and of self-control. Friends, if we've got a spirit of power, we've got nothing to be afraid of. Nothing. But fear can be a motivator. It can make us act. You know, we need to give any fear we have to God and allow Him to replace it with courage. fearful. These men who have turned the world upside down. I don't think they were passive. I don't think they showed fear. I mean, they frightened the Jews to the point they wanted to get rid of them. You know, we got to think about how Jesus displayed guts throughout his ministry. He wasn't afraid to offend the powerful leaders that were wrong. And he didn't offend them just for the sake of offending them. He stood up and told them the truth, and that offended them. Remember, you can only be offended if you want to be. Nobody can offend you unless you allow them to. And the Pharisees and the Sadducees were offended because Jesus challenged them, and they weren't used to being challenged, and they didn't like it. He defied social protocol by reaching out to touch lepers. You're not allowed to touch lepers. I mean, after all, lepers are told, if you're going down the road and you see somebody coming, you go, I'm a leper, get away! Jesus, I don't care if you're going to be coming. You can't do that. Jesus said, oh, yeah, I can. He befriended and defended the prostitutes, the tax collectors, and all the other outsiders that came to him for a new life. He ate meals with them. He conversed with them. He allowed them to touch him.
Oh, the Pharisees couldn't do that.
Author Dorothy Sayre wrote, "The people who crucified Jesus did not do so because he was a bore. Quite the contrary. He was too dynamic to be saved. He has been left for later generations to muffle up that shattering personality and surround them with an atmosphere of tedium. We have the call of the line of Judah and me in the house." I mean, friends, sometimes we do have to take a hard personal look in the mirror and say, where am I at? So, with that being said, I get behind when I start getting too excited. With that being said, it's time for self-examination. Sometimes it's hard to look in the mirror and admit some of our own faults. You know, before we protest, as Dorothy Sayre said, we need to protest. Have we really followed in the footsteps of Jesus, or just in the shadow? I mean, think about what it means now to walk in the footsteps of Jesus. We're told more than once that if you want eternal life, you've got to be willing to suffer along with Jesus. And then we have to ask, have we diminished his power in our minds to justify our own inaction because of fear and risks? You know, we've become a people who are so used to weighing out risk versus reward. Saw this in a baseball game the other night. Kansas City Royals, Cleveland Indians. Cleveland's ahead. Kansas City's up the bat. 2-0. That's what we believe. 8th inning. Kansas City sends up a pinch hitter. And of course, Kansas City has another home first and second base. So, baseball logic says, we're going to bump the ball to get those guys to first and second base. So, basically, it's going on. The guy comes up, first pitch comes in, the guy squares around the bump. It's a ball. The ball's in the dirt. First baseman, third baseman, they're as close as me and CJ by the time the ball gets to the plate because they're ready for that bump. Next pitch comes in, way outside. Finally, the pitcher drills one right down the plate. First baseman, third baseman is charging. Guy hits one off the wall, left center field. Two runs score. High risk, high risk, and high reward. You don't do that. But they took the risk and they won. You see, and the great thing about Christianity, we can take risks and win because God's on our side. And if we trust Him, the risk is minimal no matter what we think it is. Oh, He may get hurt. Because people don't always listen. You know, we've all heard the old saying, no guts, no glory. When we lack the guts to live by faith, we rob God of the glory. We're to reveal God to the world. That's why we're here. That's what the church is all about. Faithfulness is not about maintaining status quo. It's not about actively making way for the kingdom of God. Passively. It's about making way for the kingdom of God by storming the gates of the enemy. It's not about setting an armor, fortress, and fending off the attacks. It's about going out and taking the enemy on. That's why Jesus said, go into all the world. Go. Attack the enemy. Our calling is much higher than simply running away from obvious sin. We're called to chase lions. We're called to go down to that day. We're called to attack those huge Egyptians. That's not a political statement. That's just an illustration from the Bible. We're called to attack those enemies of God. See, the decisions you make today can shape the rest of your life and the life of people from every generation around. So let's quit running. Let's quit running from our lives. Trust Jesus. Go cut them down. So we don't have to worry anymore. But we can only do this with courage that comes from God. If you're here today, if you've never been baptized for this sin, you have the opportunity to be immersed. Come up out of the waters of baptism, a brand new creation, to accept all the blessings God has to offer you, to give you the courage that only He can give you, and you can live for Him. Christian, maybe you've been lacking. Go to God, ask Him for courage, ask Him for wisdom. The Bible tells us He gives generously to those who desire. Maybe you need to pray for the church for some reason, and come down front and meet myself or one of the elders and stand with me.
Of times of high and high.
to see everyone here this morning. It's great to see your visitors. Great to see Mark and Jennifer and the family. It's great. We're glad to have you here. And Rachel, glad you're here. And we hope that you stick around so we can talk to you some more and get to know you. I do have a few new announcements. One is an update on Rosa. She is home now, and we're glad to hear that. And Glenn continues to ask for prayers so she can have her strength back and for healing. So let's remember Rosa as she's back home, and let's pray that she heals up quickly and gains her strength back. Also, an update for Know Your Bible. We are still looking for some 7:30 program operators. So if you'd like to come in at 7:30 and answer the phones, it's very rewarding, and it's an in-need here for the church, so we really appreciate that. And we're also, you know, God has blessed us with the rain, and so our grass is turning green and it's growing, so we're also in need for some home mowers. So if you'd like to mow, if you can sit down and stare and not run into things, please sign up on the sheet in the back. We would love to have you, and we can spread it out a little bit. And it is it's relaxing to kind of sit and do that for about 3 hours, an hour it takes. So if you'd like to mow, please see Al. He'll give you, he'll get you all set up and give you a quick tutorial if you've never done that before. And let's remember at 2 o'clock, Sunnybrook is our services. And if you have not had a chance to attend that, it is very rewarding. The people there love the services, and they're great to talk to, and they're very appreciative. So at 2 o'clock, we're going to meet in Sunnybrook for our Sunday afternoon worship service, so please be there also. And we have our Wednesday evening service at 6 o'clock, and there's a great study there also with Steve being next. And then we have an 8 o'clock men's Bible meeting this Thursday. Make sure I remember everything. Is there anything else that we need to announce before we're dismissed in prayer?
Hospice is Tuesday night.
Hospice is Tuesday, that's right. I didn't go through all my notes. So if you would like to sign up for that, I think the sign up sheet's the back of Tuesday. And what time is it again?
6
o'clock. So 6 o'clock at the hospice house. If you'd like to be a part of that, this is great work, and it is in need there. And they can serve the meals, and also I see what's needs to be in a bar.
You want to say something about
Lance? Everyone, keep Barb and Lance in our prayers as they deal with some issues that they're going through, and we'll definitely put him on our prayer list. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we come before you as your servants, humbly and sinful Heavenly Father, asking for your forgiveness, asking for you to draw us near you, asking for you to help us to be brave, to be courageous, to fight the battles that you want us to fight, not be afraid of the issues that are out there, not to be afraid of those that will criticize us, those that will persecute us, Heavenly Father. And Father, please help us to speak up. Please help us not to be silent. Please help us to spread your word, the truth that's in it, Heavenly Father. We thank you so much for Steve's message. We ask that you give us the wisdom and the bravery that we need to serve you properly. We ask that you give us the understanding and help us not to forsake the opportunities that you give us to spread your word, to teach those who need to know you, Heavenly Father, to scatter your seed, Heavenly Father, so you can bring those into your kingdom. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the blessings that we don't deserve. We ask that you help us to never take it for granted. Help us to never take this freedom that you've given us for granted. Heavenly Father, we ask to be with those that are the leaders of this nation. Help us to turn back to you. Help us to understand that you made us a great nation because we are a Christian nation, because we love you. We ask that you remove those who do not love you and put those in place that do love you, Heavenly Father. Because we want to serve you. We want to glorify your name in all that we do and all that we say. We ask that you give this congregation, Heavenly Father, as we worship you. Help us to worship you in the spirit of truth. Heavenly Father, please give Steve the guidance to send the message to you that we need to hear. Please be with Larry and I as we help lead this congregation. And then the deacons that are also serving you, Heavenly Father. And all those in this congregation that serve you, whether we know about it or not, we know that they love you. We know this congregation loves you, Heavenly Father. And Heavenly Father, we We ask to be with those who are in need, those who are suffering. And we thank you so much for bringing Rosa home, Heavenly Father. And we ask to continue to help her to heal. Please give her hope. Help her body to gain strength. Help her to be able to enjoy this life that you've given her, Heavenly Father. To return back to worshiping you with us, Heavenly Father. And to enjoy this life and the freedoms that you give her. Please be with Glenn, Heavenly Father. And help her to encourage her. Keep him healthy, Heavenly Father. Give him his strength, Heavenly Father. Dear Heavenly Father, please give them both hope and happiness. Dear Heavenly Father, we also ask that you be with Barbara Vance, Heavenly Father. Give them wisdom, give them understanding, Heavenly Father. Please guide them and keep them looking towards your word, Heavenly Father. Dear Heavenly Father, we ask you to bless them in all that you do, in all that they do, Heavenly Father. Help them to turn to you. Dear Heavenly Father, we ask you to be with all those that we love, all those that are suffering, Heavenly Father. All those that are struggling with health and sickness. All those that are struggling in your word. Heavenly Father, we thank you for taking care of Jimmy, Heavenly Father. We ask you to continue to help his eyes to get better. We ask you to be with Ashley and help her to, her MS to decline, Heavenly Father, for the inner strength to get strong. We ask you to be with Rose's brother as he deals with his cancer. Heavenly Father, we ask you to be with Brian and Diane Gibbs' mom as they deal with the massive. And we ask you to be with Rob as he deals with his health issues, Heavenly Father. Please be with him. Please give him strength. Give him hope. Give him happiness and peace. He has to be with Gary's father as he deals with his cancer. We thank you for giving Sam Flickenstorff for a job, Heavenly Father. We ask that you help him to glorify your name because of that. Dearly Father, we ask you to be with Quinn, who has a husband who has a tumor, Heavenly Father, one of our Know Your Bible callers. Please bless him, Heavenly Father. Please heal him up. We also ask you to be with Shelby's cousin, Michael, who's dealing with a heart attack. And Mike Davis's cousin, Bob Rose's wife, passed away from Shelby. We ask you to be with him. And my sister, who's going through chemotherapy. And Father, we also are grateful for taking care of him, giving his Heavenly Father. And we ask you to continue to help him to heal up, to gain his strength, Heavenly Father. And help him to know that came from you, and no one else. And Heavenly Father, we ask you to be with his cousin's granddaughter who's dealing with some tough health issues, Heavenly Father. She prepares for surgery this August. Please remove her fears and anxieties and help her to know that she can rely on you and take care of her. Dear Heavenly Father, please be with all of us. Please deepen our faith. Please remove our anxiety, Heavenly Father. Please help us to turn it all to you. Dear Father, we ask you to be with us. Remove our fears, remove our doubt. Help us to have the confidence in our salvation. Help us to have the confidence knowing that you love us. Help us to have the confidence to know that after we're done here on earth, we have eternal salvation, eternal life with you. Please help us to always dwell on that, to never forget that. Yes, be with us now as we go back to our homes, we go back to our jobs, we go back to the life that you've given us. Help us to rejoice. Help us to look to you for all wisdom, for all guidance. Help us to be an example for those who are seeking you out, an example for those as a Christian that loves you, Heavenly Father. Help us to never forsake the opportunity to speak about you and to teach about you. We ask you to bless us now. Yes, to bless us as we serve you. We ask you to bless our lives, Heavenly Father, and bless us as your Christian, as a church. In Jesus' name I pray.
There you go.